Thank you for inviting me to this conference. Dr. Timothy Park came to my office and invited me to come here with his friends. And my topic is Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka is a republic, a pluralist society. Population is about 21 million people. And two ethnic groups are prominent, the Sinhalese-speaking and Tamil-speaking people. Religion, 70% Buddhist, Hindu, Islam, Christian is about roughly about 7 to 8%, because enumeration is not very clear there. 84% is supposed to be Catholic. Government is a republic, presidential system. Literacy is, percent literacy is 92.5, but primary education rate is 99%. So it's a literate country. Life expectancy is 79.4 years. And universal free education was there from 1945. So you can see that it's a literate country, and we can manage with Christian literature. And the Bible can be distributed among the people easily. And human rights, government has accepted human rights. So, but of course, corruption is everywhere. And from the parliament to the police, judiciary, cheating in business, bribery, all those things are common. But Jesus came to a corrupt world, and we are Christians also living in a corrupt world, and we are trying to pray for them and see at least this corruption is reduced. So from the Christianity has been there in Sri Lanka from the apostolic times, and intensive missionary work started with the arrival of the Portuguese, which was Catholic Christianity, and the Dutch came and in the 16th century, middle of the 16th century. British came in the towards the end of the 18th century, and they have been more liberal, and missionary societies have been active. Roman Catholic Church is the most powerful. We have 11 dioceses and an archbishop in Sri Lanka. So every diocese has a seminary, and there's a national seminary which trains ministers for the whole country. And we have Jesuits and oblates and all those things. They also have their own seminaries. So Protestants are divided, little over 1% of the population. Duplication of resources are there because of that. Then they are among the Christians, also Protestants. There's a competitive spirit, and all Protestants are obviously anti-Catholic. Theological education is, Catholic Church, as I told you, is well equipped. And Protestants also have about 14 theological seminaries, of which 5 are ATA recognized, and Methodists and Anglicans, traditional churches have their own theological seminary, that is a little liberal one, and the rest are evangelical seminaries. And we have 3 languages in our usage: English, Sinhala, and Tamil, and we all meet together in classes and use the same classrooms very often. And of course, common language is English. Ecumenical activities have been there from the very beginning among the Protestants, from the time of the Edinburgh Conference. National Christian Council began in 1912, and it continues today until now, and it coordinates cooperation among the traditional churches. And new churches have their own organizations. Evangelical Alliance is one, but there are several others. But they are divided, and they also have their own organizations separately. And there are mega churches in Sri Lanka, which are mostly evangelical. Assemblies of God is in Colombo is the largest church. Buddhism, Hinduism, and Islam are ethnic religions, whereas Christianity, whether Catholic or Protestant, are not ethnic. They cut across all the ethnic boundaries. Therefore, national reconciliation is possible because through the church, and the Christian leaders have been prominent in the field of in that field. They have got together in national prayer meetings, and all religious discussions and all those things. Therefore, they have been cooperating with the nation to overcome certain problems. And then with regard to Protestants, especially the evangelicals, there is persecution in the country. Buddhist monks are going out to attack Christian churches. During the last government, it was more difficult, and they came to churches and assaulted the pastors. But this time, under this new government, it is not as prominent as that. And you can go to a police station and report. In the previous government time, it was not possible. But now, because of the persecution, the Christians have what we call fellowships. In each district, we have 25 districts. Each district have fellowships. And in those fellowships, Catholics and Protestants and evangelicals get together and pray for each other and discuss what they can do with regard to this persecution. So local fellowships have been very useful. Therefore, Sri Lanka is multi-ethnic, multi-religious country. There's another problem that we have with regard to Christianity is a minority. Therefore, the biggest problem is mixed marriages. Mixed marriages means our youth meet in classrooms, universities, job, workplaces. Therefore, young people in schools, colleges. So the denominational barriers are broken. Not only that, even the religious barriers are broken. Therefore, the church has to have a proper policy with regard to mixed marriages. We have not had it. So it is very, that's a risky thing. So that church has not taken that into account. Then opposition to Christianity comes mostly from the Buddhists. So Buddhist opposition has been there, and it has been, it had been, you know, ups and downs. During the last government, it was very high. So the complaints made by Christians to the police stations have been ignored during those days. Now, there is some relief. Missionary visas have been curtailed since 1962. Therefore, only few missionaries can come to Sri Lanka. So the work is mostly done by the Sri Lankans. So Sri Lankans are capable of doing it. We have high literacy rate, whereas all our governments and parliaments and democratic system has become national, Christianity has lagged behind. Still our church, even at the time of independence, Christianity was foreign managed. Now it is local managed, but it is elite managed. You see, English speaking, Colombo educated folks are managing the church. So that difficulty is there. And also we have lots of them depend on foreign funds. So there is abuse of foreign funds, especially in the use of funds. I mean, government also has accused the World Vision and Compassion International for using their funds to fund terrorist organizations. So, but anyhow, fundraising is significant, but it is in many churches, but I think it is not necessary, because Sri Lankans can, Buddhist establishment is doing very well without foreign funds, and in fact they send out also. And there is one church in Sri Lanka which is bigger, mega church, called Calvary Church. They don't accept foreign funds. They send foreign missionaries to foreign countries. They are scattered all. I mean, their churches are all over the place. So future, future lies in the youth and the children, not this generation, not us. We have to, our church has neglected both. There are no church, I mean, proper organizing methods of managing the youth affairs. So that's why mixed marriages take place. And the children, Sunday school system is in disarray. I mean, Buddhists have overtaken all that, and they are doing better Sunday schools than the Christians. There should be some united action with regard to these things, mixed marriages, youth affairs, and children's education. Then there are liberal theological seminaries where they learn various things and impart those things, I mean, vomit those ideas to the congregation, and congregations don't like it, and also the decline of some Christian villages are known. So, and the other thing, most of the churches, growing churches, are managed by first generation Christians. They need Christian ethics, and they need leaders, good leaders, and ordinary people should be able to see role models in Christian churches. That is lacking. So therefore, these are the questions, the things that we have to pray for. Thank you very much.